Examination of varicose veins. Varicose vein is an elongated, dilated, and tortuous vein in the subcutaneous layer. On inspection, we will first inspect the vein and then the ankle and the foot. On inspection of the vein in standing position, first note the site and extent of the varicosity and whether it conforms to the anatomical path of the long or short saphenous veins. Long saphenous varicosities run from the front of the medial malleolus upwards along the anteromedial aspect of the leg, knee and the thigh to end at the saphenous opening just below the inguinal ligament. The short saphenous varicosities run over the posterior aspect of the calf to converge and end at the center of the popliteal fossa. Some varicosities may not conform to these anatomical pathways and are termed as stray varicosities. So inspect the long saphenous system, the short saphenous system, and their relation to the present varicosity. For this, you must examine the leg from all the sides, front and back. Now inspect the length of the varicose vein for a blowout or a localized bulge in the vein indicating incompetent perforator. This is a blowout in the leg. In this patient, two blowouts are seen in the thigh. When a blowout is seen, mark it with a skin pencil. Next, inspect the saphenous opening below the inguinal ligament for a saphena varix. Saphena varix is a blowout over the saphenofemoral junction and it indicates saphenofemoral valve incompetence. If a saphena varix is seen, ask the patient to cough and look for a visible cough impulse. Now look for dilated veins over the lower abdomen above the inguinal ligament converging onto the saphenous opening. These are the superficial circumflex iliac, superficial inferior epigastric and superficial external pudendal veins which enter the long saphenous vein just before it joins the femoral vein. Now raise the leg to 60 degrees and check whether the varicosity collapses or not. An uncomplicated varicose vein will always collapse on raising the leg. But if it is secondary to pelvic vein thrombosis or arteriovenous fistula in the leg, then it will not collapse when the leg is raised. Holding the leg elevated to 30 degrees or more, ask the patient to cough and look for a cough impulse at the saphenous opening. If a saphena varix is present, it will be seen to bulge out and a retrograde venous pressure wave will be seen to rise in the empty vein and fall slowly. This is Morris's test. Positive Morris's test indicates incompetency of saphenofemoral wall. Note again the retrograde venous pressure wave which rises up on coughing and then slowly falls. Now we will inspect the ankle and the foot. Inspect the medial aspect of the ankle for ankle flare or the venous flare. It is a diffuse soft swelling or fullness with small subcutaneous dilated venules around the ankle, usually filling the hollow between the medial malleolus and the heel. Note the tiny subcutaneous dilated venules. Ankle flare is seen in association with incompetency of ankle perforators. Now inspect the skin over the medial aspect of the lower third of the leg for pigmentation, edema, oozing or ulceration. These are changes in the skin due to the back pressure in the veins and capillaries which forces the RBCs out of the vessel walls. The RBCs are broken down by macrophages and from the breakdown products of hemoglobin, hemosiderin produces black pigmentation while biliverdin produces irritation and itching leading to dermatitis. Note the typical dark pigmentation and dermatitis over the medial aspect of the ankle and the lower third of the leg. and the varicose veins in the upper part of the leg. In this patient, we see a typical varicose ulcer. Note its typical location over the medial aspect of the lower third of the leg, also termed as the gaiter area. Then note the surrounding dark pigmentation and the dilated veins. Varicose ulcer is more commonly seen after a deep vein thrombosis and sometimes with primary varicose veins. Deep vein thrombosis damages the walls of the deep veins of the leg, so the blood is pumped into the superficial veins, particularly on the medial side where the perforating veins are situated. This is another large varicose ulcer over the medial aspect of the ankle, surrounded by dark pigmentation and dermatitis. Note that the varicose ulcers are always superficial, painless, with ragged, irregular edges and unhealthy granulations. They never penetrate the deep fascia. If varicose ulcer or severe dermatitis is seen, note whether the foot shows a talipes equinus deformity and whether the patient walks limping on the toes. Note the talipes equinus deformity due to contracture of the soft tissues on the medial aspect of the ankle due to a chronic varicose ulcer. To revise, on inspection, first inspect the vein for the site, extent, and anatomical relation of the vein. Look for blowouts, saphenavarics, and dilated veins over the lower abdomen. Then raise the leg to 60 degrees to check whether the varicosity collapses and ask the patient to cuff, looking for retrograde venous pressure wave, that is Morris's test. Now inspect the ankle and the lower third of the leg for ankle flare, hyperpigmentation of the skin, edema, dermatitis or ulceration. And if a varicose ulcer be present, look for talipes equinus deformity of the ankle. Now let us proceed to palpation. With the patient in standing position, palpate the length of the vein for warmth and tenderness. Superficial thrombophlebitis in acute stage will be warm and tender. In this patient, note the cord-like thickening and redness along the vein, suggesting superficial thrombophlebitis in this varicose vein. Now mark the course of the vein with a skin pencil. Make the patient lie down. Raise the leg to 30 degrees and empty the vein. Now palpate the deep fascia along the course of the vein more carefully at the site of blowouts, if any, to look for pits in the deep fascia. A pit is felt as a circular defect in the deep fascia with sharp edges and indicates the site of a dilated perforator. If a pit is felt, mark it with a cross with a skin pencil. This is Fagan's method of palpation for detection of incompetent perforators. Now keep your hand gently over the saphenous opening, which is located 3.8 centimeters below and lateral to the pubic tubercle, and ask the patient to cuff. A cuff impulse indicates saphenofemoral wall incompetence. If a saphenavarix be present, a thrill will be palpable when the patient cuffs, as if a jet of water is entering and filling the varix. This is the Cruvelier sign of saphenavarix. Ask the patient to look to the opposite side when he is cuffing. Note again the expansile impulse in the saphenavarix when the patient cuffs. Now, with the patient standing, place the fingers of the left hand over the saphenous opening and tap over the most prominent part of the varicosity in the leg with the right hand. If the impulse is felt by the palpating fingers, it indicates that there is a continuous blood column between the two points and the vein walls are incompetent. This is positive tap test or Schwarz test. Now perform the Brody-Trendelenburg test. It will tell us whether the saphenofemoral junction is competent or not, and whether there is any other perforator incompetence. with the patient lying down supine, elevate the leg to 30 degrees and empty the vein completely. Now press the thumb to occlude the saphenous opening. If there is a large saphena varix, use the other four fingers. Keeping the saphenofemoral junction pressed and occluded, ask the patient to stand. Compressing the vein by the thumb is not always accurate, particularly if the vein is not visible or the patient is obese. So the test is better performed with a rubber tourniquet tied around the upper thigh just below the saphenous opening. Observe the vein for 15 to 30 seconds with maintained pressure. The vein will remain empty if it is a pure saphenofemoral incompetence. But if there is a perforator incompetence in the leg, the vein will fill slowly from below upwards. Now release the hand pressing on the saphenous opening and watch how the varicosity fills rapidly from above. If saphenofemoral valve is incompetent, the varicosity will fill very rapidly from above downwards. If saphenofemoral valve is competent, there will be no retrograde filling. This test report is mentioned as negative positive, that is, negative with maintained pressure and positive on release of pressure, indicating a pure saphenofemoral valve incompetence. Positive negative result implies only perforator incompetence, and positive positive result implies incompetency of both saphenofemoral valve and the perforators. Note again how the vein fills rapidly on releasing the tourniquet. Now we will perform the multiple tourniquet test. With the patient supine, elevate the leg and empty the veins completely by milking them down. Now apply three rubber tourniquets. One just below the saphenous opening, second just above the knee, and third just below the knee. This divides the long saphenous vein into four segments, each with one constant perforator. The saphenofemoral valve above the first tourniquet, the mid-thigh perforator in adductor canal between the first and the second tourniquets, the below-knee perforator between the second and end tourniquets, and the ankle perforators below the third tourniquet. The tourniquets should be just tight enough to occlude only the superficial veins. Now ask the patient to stand up and observe for 15 to 20 seconds for the appearance of varicosities in each segment. A rapid appearance of a varicosity or a blowout in any of the segments indicates the incompetency of the related perforator. In the segments with competent perforators, the vein remains collapsed. Next, we will perform the Pratt's test. This test is performed to locate the incompetent perforators more accurately. With the patient supine, raise the leg to 30 degrees, empty the veins and apply an elastocrepe bandage from the toes to the mid-thigh with gentle pressure to occlude the superficial veins only. Now apply a rubber tourniquet below the saphenofemoral valve to occlude retrograde flow from the saphenofemoral valve. Now ask the patient to stand and release the bandage from above downwards. After releasing each turn, observe the vein for filling. The moment the turn of the bandage over an incompetent perforator is unwound, the vein will fill rapidly. So to revise, on palpation, we first palpated the length of the vein for warmth and tenderness. Then we emptied the vein and palpated the deep fascia under it by Fagan's method for palpable pits. Then we tested for cuff impulse and Cruvelier's sign at the saphenous opening and performed the tap test or Schwarz test. Then we performed the special tests for incompetent perforators, that is Brody-Trendelenburg test, multiple tourniquet test and the Pratt's test. Thus, we have completed the examination of the varicose veins and the tests for incompetent perforators. Next, you should look for patency of the deep veins and for active deep vein thrombosis. The patency of the deep veins is tested by modified Perthes test. With the patient supine, elevate the limb and empty the vein. Apply a rubber tourniquet over the upper thigh to occlude the superficial veins. Then ask the patient to walk around briskly for 5 minutes. If the deep veins are blocked, the varicosities will become turgid and the patient will experience throbbing pain in the calf. This is a positive Perthes test. If deep veins are patent, the varicosities will remain collapsed and there is no calf pain. A positive Perthes test is an absolute contraindication for ligation and stripping of the veins, and it must be routinely performed before surgery. The same test, if performed by applying an elastocrepe bandage from the toes to the thigh, is the original Perthes test. Now we will look for active deep vein thrombosis. For this, look for tender swelling of the calf. Palpate for tenderness along the course of the femoral vein, popliteal vein, and over the calf muscles for the posterior tibial veins. And lastly, look for the Homan's sign and the Moses sign. To test for tenderness over the deep veins over the calf, flex the knee to 90 degrees to rest the foot on the table and press the calf muscles against the tibia to compress the posterior tibial veins. If this is not tender, gently squeeze the calf muscles from side to side. If painful, this is a positive Moses sign. If the calf muscles are tender, do not perform the test, as squeezing of the calf muscles can potentially dislodge a thrombus in the deep veins and result in pulmonary embolism. Now let the leg rest with the knee fully extended for the Homan's sign. Dorsiflex the foot passively. The resultant stretching of the calf muscles and the posterior tibial vein elicits pain if the deep veins are thrombosed and painful. This is a positive Homan's sign. Let me repeat that in active deep vein thrombosis, all these tests should be performed very gently, as potentially they can dislodge a thrombus and cause pulmonary embolism. Next, palpate the inguinal lymph nodes, which may be enlarged with varicose ulcers and deep vein thrombosis. Examine the opposite leg for varicose veins. Palpate the abdomen for any lump pressing on the pelvic veins. Examine the scrotum in standing position for varicocele and testicular tumor. And perform proctoscopy to rule out coexisting hemorrhoids. This completes the clinical examination of a case of varicose veins.